Gamecast. Well, there's GameCube and then there's Dreamcast. What you thought?
Well, I said I got Gamecast, man! Damn, I can't afford it!
Here we are. This is, the first ever time that we've ever had a podcast ever under this name. Jake, hello.
Hi.
So, I wanted to start it off, since this is the first of the Yo Gamecast, we might have a new audience that may not be familiar with what we've done in the past. So, would you like to talk about yourself for a little bit?
Sure, I can talk about myself for a little bit. These days, I go by the tag Enigma. My name is Jake. Some of you may recognize me from other things that I've done on the internet. I used to be a Poketuber, much like the bearded gentleman beside me.
Sure.
And we also did a little show. I ran a podcast called The 2.5 Gamers. There was another full gamer involved in that, and his name was NBZ.
I think with this sort of fullness here, I think I should be the full gamer.
No, you're still like 4 foot.
I'm sorry, I'm not a monster and 6 foot six.
Dude, I'm not 6 foot six. I wish I was 6 foot six. Then I could be taller than people I work with. Yeah, I basically did the podcast with Fizz here along with MBZ. It was just a passion project of mine. These days, I'm just really big into Smash Bros. That's what the SSB is on the end of my tag, because somebody took the name Enigma.
Of course.
But I'm able to get Enigma SSB across everything except for Nintendo, because apparently the word ass is banned. So
I didn't even see that. What if you
I didn't even see it until like the sixth time. They were like, yeah, you can't do that.
What if you wanted to be like Mass Effect fan?
Can't.
No. Okay.
Can't be a fan of the ass.
Well,
which sucks,
I am,
because that is clearly what I am a fan of.
Yeah. So last time we did a podcast under the 2.5 Gamers name, you played a whole lot of League of Legends. Do you still play League, or are you focusing all of your efforts in Smash?
Well, I obviously still play League. I don't think you could dedicate as many hours and dollars into a game that I have on that one and then just drop it completely.
Sure.
It's not something that I'm playing all the time. To be fair, I don't even play Smash all the time. Between work and trying to work through some of my backlog, it's like,
right,
oh, what am I going to play today? And usually Smash is like at night after work, where I just hop on Wi-Fi and play with some friends to get better. And then Sundays are our locals, so I go to a weekly every Sunday, and Mondays basically whatever I want. Yesterday sucked. We just released our power rankings for British Columbia, specifically the Vancouver region. We didn't really include the island. And in my pool, I had two of the top 10 players, and only two players made it out of pools. So I was basically like World Cup group of death, and I don't even remember who else was in it, but I was one of the two that didn't make it out of pools. That's all you need to know.
Dang, that's rough. That is rough.
In my defense, I did get a chance to play against one of our other top 10 players. He's actually number 3 in the region, and I beat him in friendlies, so
hey.
I'm trying to basically, it's funny because we're both named Jake. And I have picked up Yoshi to be a fraud just to play against him. So I basically just want to become the Jake that somebody talks about at some point. Because every time it's like, hey, Jake, and it's not me.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Been there, man. Awesome. For myself, if you're seeing this, then you're probably familiar with me a little bit. I'm a big into Hearthstone right now.
I play Hearthstone.
Dude, yeah, that's right. That's right, you do. Team White Girl Wasted. Just like the most,
we are an official esports team.
The most passive, team that's ever existed.
Made money.
That's true.
Off a fantastically run tournament. And I highly suggest everybody go sign up for it if they ever do another one. Don't do it. It was so
no,
bad.
No, it was. I don't even remember what they were called. It was so bad. I think collectively, between the three of us, we made $30 or something like that. In between 30 and 40, so, you know, we're a big deal.
Sports.
Yeah. So, every day, almost, I'm playing Hearthstone. You know, and you may know me from my past stuff. You may know me for the channel that I'm already on, that you may be seeing this on later. Gosh, what to say about me? I don't know. I really don't know. You might remember me from the past, so playing Pokemon stuff. And now I'm moving on to smaller but hopefully better things. So, what have you been playing? Anything out of the ordinary? Anything other than Smash and League?
Actually, you know what? In the past almost 2 weeks, I think I've logged on to League of Legends one time. Yeah, it's mostly just Smash. We did at my workplace, I work at a video game themed restaurant down,
yes.
Not quite downtown, but downtown Vancouver. And we just last week did a Super Nintendo kind of charity event.
Oh, cool.
So I basically, when I was done work, I got to hop on and play a little bit of like original Mario Kart. And we did some like Japanese Gundam Fighter that I had no idea what I was doing.
That's awesome.
It was ridiculous. It was a lot of fun. And what else? What did we play there? Street Fighter 2. Both Turbo Edition and Regular Edition were there. And every day I play a little bit of Chrono Trigger because it's sitting on my table there in my Super Nintendo. And you got to go through it. I basically go through it once a year because that game is amazing.
Yeah, dude. You know what? Amazing game I've been playing, and I haven't talked to you about it because I thought it would be cool to talk about it on here because it's your favorite IP. I've been playing through Mega Man X for the first time ever for me.
Oh, God.
I know!
Let me just say, I'm really sad that I didn't pick it up. I saw this game a couple of weeks ago for $60, which is a steal for Mega Man X, at least in Canada. And I didn't pick it up.
What a shame.
Because now it's like, I'm going to be probably paying 3 digits for it.
Dang. That's insane. Oh, man.
How are you enjoying it, though?
Fuck, I love it.
Mega Man X is fantastic.
Yeah.
The soundtrack in the X series is just phenomenal. Not that Mega Man has a bad soundtrack in any series.
No, they're all great.
But X just, it was, for me, it was like the pinnacle of the action platformer on the Super Nintendo. Obviously, there's like Metroids, there's obviously the Castlevania games, but for me, it was, my childhood was all Mega Man, so there's just so much nostalgia there.
Yeah. Oh, man. Like, I never played it when I was little, but like, immediately I was, like, taken back, because I did play, like, a lot of... Super Nintendo was, like, my jam. Like,
I will fight to the death that is the greatest console ever made.
Oh, I could definitely hop on board that argument, but, like, I would walk to, like, the video store, because there was one, like, 2 miles away, and I would just walk to it, like, every week with, like, the $5 I made from, like, chores and stuff, and I would just rent a new game. But I never got to play X when I was little. But like
the days when you actually went to a Blockbuster and rented video games.
This was a mom and pop one. It was called Home Video Plus. I have fun.
I mean, just like in general, like that I went to wasn't a Blockbuster either. But
to generalize people who are
that's how old we are. We were around with Blockbuster.
Yeah, dude. You know how many times I rented Mega Man Soccer? So many. But as far as Mega Man X goes, I just beat all the dudes. I got all the heart tanks, the sub guys, and I just got the Hadouken power up.
Oh, okay. Hadouken is stupid broken, but it's awesome.
Like, I didn't know it existed, and I stumbled across the fact that it did, and I was like, oh, I gotta find out how to get this.
Yeah, the thing with the X series is they almost always have a crossover with Street Fighter, so it's the Hadouken.
And X2, it's the Shuriken.
Yep.
Yeah. Because I accidentally stumbled across that when I was looking for Hadouken stuff. But, like, I was, like, trying to do it, and then I was like, wait. And then I started looking up videos of it. I was like, oh, his health bar is bigger than mine by just a teeny bit. And then I had to, like, go through and be like, which heart tank did I miss? I was like, oh, it's fucking this one. Went back, and then the as soon as I did it that time, I was like, oh, fuck, it's real. Because I was, like, super skeptical about it. And I was like, oh, shit,
I remember finding that as a kid.
Yeah.
I found that as a kid, and I think I legitimately crapped myself.
Really? Like, how do you even think to do that? Like, as a kid?
I didn't think. It was just, I was so blown away that the fact that I could Hadouken somebody.
Yeah.
Like, every time I did it, you always yell Hadouken.
Oh, for sure. And, like, I love his little yell, too, because he says it also. I'm like, fuck, this is great. I haven't actually got to use it on anyone yet.
Like Kirby Falcon Punching in Smash Bros. Falcon Punch!
I literally...
Kirby's got the best voiceovers in those games.
Yeah. I got it right before we started trying to start the show. So I'm like...
Oh, so this is why we were late, because you were getting the Hadouken.
No. That wasn't it at all. It was because my everything just started to crap itself. But it's good now. But, like, I was playing Mega Man X right up until, like, 1 o'clock when we decided to meet. I was like, all right. And I was like, shit, got a Hadouken. And then I was just, like, looking through some stuff. I was like, all right, I should probably get started, set up stuff. Did not experience
idea.
All the technical difficulties that we encountered. Hey, Jake. May the 4th
Yo,
be
Biz.
With you. It's Star Wars Day, everybody.
It is. I'm decked out in Star Wars.
Oh,
apparel.
Same. I got these breakdancing dudes.
You've got breakdancing. Okay, that's amazing. I want that shirt right now.
You can't have it. I found it in a Macy's on a clearance rack for $5.
God
the
damn
only
it.
One, and it was my size. Like, yes.
I probably had a bad day that day.
You probably had the shittiest day.
For those of you who don't know, Mike is the yin to my yang. Whenever one of us has a good day, the other one has a really bad day.
It's so true.
So the fact that he's had a pretty crappy morning means I'm probably in for a really good day.
Yeah. Yeah, it's true. Did you get my direct message of the screenshot?
The blue screen? Yeah,
yeah.
I did.
Fucking blue screen.
That was right before I tweeted out how amazing the show has already gotten off on.
I think it's pretty amazing now that things are settled.
Now that it works, yeah. It's fun.
You know, after my computer crashed, my headset started working properly. I was like, hell yeah. Sometimes you just need to crash your system, dude. That's all it takes.
System reboot, always the way to go.
Star Wars Celebration happened. Today's Star Wars Day. It's not necessarily video games, but I figure it falls under the same umbrella of,
Wait,
pop culture and nerd
game
culture.
Show?
Huh?
This is a video game show?
Yeah, sure. Whatever. It's got game in the title. Whatever. Star Wars Celebration happened, though. Let's talk in the Star Wars Day, so let's talk Star Wars.
Okay.
Obviously, you watched the trailer, because you'd be stupid not to, yeah?
Trailer? Are you kidding me? I've probably looped that so many times, it's longer than the movie.
I have, fun fact, I've seen the trailer one time in full.
But, okay, did you get emotional during that trailer? Because I teared up a bit.
I get emotional every time I hear the bang.
That's true. That's
I'm just like,
true.
Oh my god, I'm crying. but yeah, like, I love it, how it looks right now. It looks great, grimy and gritty, like the original.
Oh, that the quick cut of the bloody handprint on the face of the helmet. That was...
Yeah.
I was like, I'm already in.
Yeah.
Like, let's go.
Yeah. I at this point, I'm very excited. When the first trailer came out, I was like, oh, yeah, it's kind of cool. Didn't really see anything. And
yeah,
I've been,
well, that's the point.
Yeah. I'm, like, cautiously optimistic. And, like, I just don't want to get too excited because I've been... My heart's been broken before. It's been broken before. And
it,
so,
it has.
Yeah.
But I am... let's be honest. I don't know about you, but after that trailer they released at Celebration... I'm basically ready to bend over and spread them and be like, I'm ready.
Let
One
it
way
in.
Or the other. One way or the other. Like, if it's really bad, I'm
sure.
already been prepared. There's a bottle of Vaseline, and I've got some ice cream on standby. And if it's really good, then yes, let's get back into some good Star Wars, because it's been a very, very, very long time since Endor.
That's true. I'm going to take some of that out of context later. I'm going to remind myself, future Mike, save some of that audio.
I don't even care.
Yeah, that's great. Good.
Put it on a t-shirt. Yeah. I'll wear the crap out of it.
Eventually I want to make a soundboard so I can just like hit a key and then you'll just be like, I'm ready to take it all.
Press another key. You've got a bottle of Vaseline on standby.
Yeah, exactly. It's going to be great. did you watch the panel at all? Because I did.
I didn't get a chance to watch the panel, and it's been something that I'd like to go back and watch. It's just I haven't had a ton of time. These last, basically since Celebration, my schedule keeps changing at work because I have to cover for other people, and I'm basically just... I'm at the point where it's like, all right, that's fine. I'm just cashing in a bunch of favors at the end of the year when I take a week off to go camp out and get in for the midnight release of Star Wars.
There
so.
You go. Yeah, there's no way that I will not be there at midnight. I can't see it.
I'm going to be there, and I'm going to be decked out. I haven't decided what I'm going to wear, but
oh,
I'm going to cosplay
snap.
For that. Like, you can't go to a midnight release of a Star Wars movie and not get into it.
I've never dressed up for a Star Wars release, but I've always been...
I've never been to a Star Wars release.
Really?
So, not a midnight release, no, because, like,
I think I've always...
Episode 1 came out, it was, what, 98?
99,
so I was still a youngling. I wasn't able to go to no midnight release.
Yeah, me
and,
too.
And when... The only one I would have been able to would have been, like, Episode 3, and, like, after Episode 1 and Episode 2, I'm like, I don't really want to... go to a midnight release. I wasn't that excited for it.
I went to
it actually
three
took
midnight
me,
release.
Okay, let me think. I think I watched Episode 3 for the first time 2007.
What year did it come out? 05? 04?
It was like 3 years after it came out before I actually was like, okay, I'll watch this movie.
Wow. See,
that
was
just how much I had like... been disappointed. I had been crushed to the very depths of my
yeah.
soul.
I was not that. I'm always ready to jump back in because I'm always yeah, fuck it, dude. You know, so what? Clone Wars sucked. Let's try again. And I get so into it that when I saw it at midnight on the first night, I didn't even think it was bad at first because I was just so excited to be there. As it just
to be
swept
fair,
up.
Looking back, Episode 2 and Episode 3 aren't that bad.
They're
like, they're not good
written.
By any means,
yeah.
but they have good... like.
Sure, they all
I
have
love,
good moments.
I love the fight scene between Obi-Wan and Anakin at the end of Episode 3. Like, I thought that was a good fight scene.
Sure. I mean, I don't think they're... like, I don't think their fight scenes were ever bad in those movies. It's just they're so
no,
badly
that's
written.
That's kind of like the saving grace of those movies.
Yeah.
The fact that they got to do a lot of the things that you couldn't do in the prequels because technology wasn't there.
Yeah. But they, then they overdid it and they made it
but
too sterile.
But then they also had
just,
horrible acting.
Yeah. That's bad. So, I watched the panel. It was a fun watch. I'd say if whenever you got time, definitely go back and watch it. It's definitely worthwhile. And then
Carrie Fisher was just in Vancouver right before Celebration. She was at we have a yearly event called Fan Expo, and some of my coworkers were there, and they actually went to the Carrie Fisher panel, and they're like, she was just hilarious. She was like laid back. She was like in one of those director's chairs. She's just kind of like sprawled out, just kind of doing whatever she wants. It was great.
I love Carrie Fisher. She's awesome. Did you ever see, what's it called? Like Fanboys, I think it's called.
Are you kidding me? I watch that movie all the time. I love
that movie. So well done. But yeah, she's great in that movie too. Like her part's very small, but
the doctor. But I mean, they all played a part in that movie is the thing.
Yeah.
They just wanted to get all the cameos, and it was.
Yeah.
And Lando was the judge or like the police chief or something.
Yeah, something like that. It's been a while since I watched it, but
it's been a while for me.
When I saw it, I fell in love with it. I love it so much.
It was just.
There's
so
a fun
many
watch.
Just hilarious moments that are just so well done. Like the they're in the van and they've got the peyote.
Yeah.
And like they have to hit light speed.
Yeah.
And it's just like taken directly from the movie.
Yeah.
It's so good.
So good. One of my favorite scenes is the scene with Seth Rogen where he like preemptively got the Jar Jar Binks tattoo. He's like, see that little dude? He's gonna be badass, man.
It's like his entire back.
Yeah. Oh my god. Great watch. Now to round out, the talk of Star Wars and the celebration, the Battlefront trailer. What do you think of it?
Let me tell you a little thing about Battlefront.
Okay, tell me.
I got invited to playtest that game.
The new one? The old one?
The new one.
And?
I had to work that day.
Kill me.
It happened to my sous chef, too. On the same day, we showed up to work, and we were both like, come and play Battlefront right now. And I looked at him like, me too! But, there's an EA office here in not just Vancouver, but actually in my little suburb of Burnaby.
Burnaby.
Burnaby. And all the time I'm getting emails like, hey, an upcoming playtest is available. So it's either for like Battlefront or probably any of the sports games that EA puts out. Mm-hmm. And I'm always like, I really, really want to go play Battlefront because Battlefront 1, Battlefront 2. Amazing games, some of my favorite games that ever got put out.
I should see if EA's got an office around here.
Probably don't.
We might. I'm right down this. I'm not too far from like Marin, which is where like everything technology happens.
I don't know.
I'm not sure about EA.
Think they have one in that area. I know there's the one here. I think there's one in Alberta.
Yeah.
And I feel like it's in like Florida.
Oh, weird.
Is the other main one? Maybe Santa Monica. I don't know.
That sounds more likely.
Well, I know like EA Sports has offices in Florida.
Yeah.
Because I mean, if you've ever played a Madden game, it's like they have Tiburon plastered everywhere.
Yeah.
But yeah, Battlefront, the trailers they put out, I reserved until I get to play the game because I want to see actual gameplay as opposed to
footage,
CGI render. Regardless if it's in the engine or not. I already know the Frost engine is phenomenal. But I want to see the actual gameplay and the thing that I really need to see, and we make jokes about this at work all the time, is are we getting a typical EA, we're going to fuck you kind of business model? Like, can I unlock Anakin Skywalker or Darth Vader as a playable character? But if I want to use his lightsaber, I got to pay $2. Mm-hmm. It's like, are they going to do microtransactions, or is this legitimately going to be a unlock them as you play the game? There have to be certain parameters, like the way the Battlefront the originals did it, where you didn't just put down money, but okay, now I get to play as Darth Vader and I win.
Yeah. they'll probably do something like that, and I hope the way they do it is I hope they make, the best example I could think of, and I'm sure there's plenty just like it, is that, 2K, like the WWE games, they'll have, like, an accelerator, or you can just go in and pay, like, $20 and just unlock everything, and then you're like, fuck, we're good. And I, if they do it that way, that's fine, as long as everything's unlockable via gameplay as well.
The only DLC that I will be content with is things that add on to an already finished game.
Right, like,
so like if you look at stuff. Yeah, maps I'm okay with, especially if you want to have a, like a longevity of, yeah, of the game, where like assuming that it's going to be very online driven, like every other shooter that's come out in the past almost decade, they're gonna put out map packs, which I'm okay with, especially if they're really well done and they bring you to other places. Like, imagine, say, we get new planets in the new trilogy that they put out.
Sure.
So they put out DLC, like, hey, now you get to relive some of these epic fight scenes. I'm fine with that. I would be okay with cosmetic changes, a la, like, any MOBA or...
Sure, some skins.
Like, even, like, CSGO, I'm sure, does it. But I don't want to see, like, pay $15 to unlock Darth Vader and Obi-Wan Kenobi, and those are the only ways that you can get those characters in game.
Oh,
and
then by
you
the way, they're
unlock
the best.
The next tier of like Yoda and the Emperor, and like Yoda and the Emperor are just unbalancedly strong because they're the masters, right? Like, sure. As long as the game is balanced and it's not pay to win, I'm fine with it. As long as the DLC is not something that I would deem should have been put in the initial product.
Totally.
Maps, you can argue that, hey, they could have been put in. But if they're coming out months down the road, I'm fine with it. But I don't want no, like, day one DLC. It's like, hey, pay an extra $10 and we'll give you 3 extra planets that you can fight on.
Yeah,
like,
that's always bullshit.
You can add $5 to the initial release price and I'll do it then. But don't make me pay an extra $10 for something that you've already done.
Yeah.
Just to try and get an extra chunk of change out of it.
Right, yeah. That stuff's always garbage. When the Battlefront trailer came out, and like I think I worked the next day, and they were like talking about it, and they're like, "Oh, dude, it looks so sick! This is gameplay." I was like, "You realize that's not actual gameplay? That's just they just rendered that shit in the fucking what's the word I'm looking for?
Engine,
bang bang. That's not how it's gonna look." Because my like, friend was like,
environment? Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, shit, dude, it looks like real fucking people. I was like, I don't think you understand how this works.
Yeah, it's like, the camera angles and whatnot aren't going to be the same. They can't do that high quality of, like, action sequences in the game because Battlefront is, like, 200 on 200, technically. Like, you have a limit. There's massive fighting going on. If you did that, your consoles can't run that. My PC wouldn't be able to run that. Yeah. Like, not unless I'm paying $3,000 for a PC. Like, you have to have performance in mind.
Yeah.
There have to be realistic expectations. Every time I see that there's a Battlefront playtest upcoming, I sign up for it. If I ever get a chance to play it and they don't make me sign an NDA, I will tell you how good it is.
Sure.
But until I actually get to play the game, as hyped as I am, I mean, it's on par with the movie because of how much I love the Battlefront franchise. I'm still reserved because it's an EA title.
Yeah, that's true.
If it was any other company, you'd have me on board 100%. But much like the reservations that any true Star Wars fan will have about the movies based on the prequel trilogy.
Yep.
You're going to have reservations about any game that's pumped out by a company that is year after year after year nominated as one of the worst companies in America. Like, you can't overlook that fact.
Sure. Being a Star Wars fan is really hard. It's really, really difficult.
Ahsoka lives, bro.
Dude.
It's not that hard anymore. Let's be honest. Those like those animated series for like the Clone Wars and
I didn't finish yet. I'm still somewhere in the last season.
I just finished the like unreleased season 6. I finished that the other night.
I'm somewhere in there.
I'm going to go to Rebels.
Yes.
I mean, sorry if you got spoiled. Anyone who watched this, that found out Ahsoka lives, but if you watched Celebration, you heard about it. Yep. That's how I know.
That's how I know, too. I was like, oh, there's Ahsoka and Rebels. Oh, right.
I'm fine with that, too. I love Ahsoka.
Dude, Snips, man. She's the best.
Snips is the best. I was, like, when they got rid of her, I think I legitimately cried at the end of that episode where she kind of like, I'm going to go do my own thing because you don't trust me. And I'm like, but what happens to her? Because she's obviously not in anything else. And now I'm like so into watching Rebels season 2. And I'm hoping that like somehow throughout the course of Rebels, she doesn't. Like nothing really major happens to her. Sure. And then she shows up in this new trilogy. And then I would crap my pants just like I
was. You know, she would have to be so old.
Not really, because she's a kid in the Clone Wars.
Right. So then she'd be like 25 by the time A New Hope is.
It's like 30 years after that. 30. And I would imagine, like, I don't, you're not talking to some super hardcore, I know so many crazy facts about the Star Wars universe kind of nerd.
Right.
But I would imagine that her race is not like a human where she's like 50
She's not going to look like Han Solo. Like,
yeah. Cause,
sure. You know what irks me about the trailer? The only thing that irked me is Chewie doesn't have any gray hair. Don't Wookiees gray a little?
They do, but he's very young for a Wookiee. Like, think of it like, I believe they talked about it in one of the panels at Celebration in regards to, because someone brought it up, it's like, how come he doesn't have any gray on him?
Sure.
And they're like, well, he's about, I think someone said he's like 200 years old, which is incredibly young for a Wookiee. All
right.
So, like, 30 years is like, are you really going to gray that much in 30 years?
When,
like, not really. Imagine he's like entering maybe his midlife crisis. I don't know the actual lifespan.
Yeah, with the timeline of a Wookiee life.
But if it's like, imagine they live like 500 years, he's not going to look like Yoda until he's like 450.
When he's,
maybe he's just like Asians. They don't age until like they hit 80 and then they hit it hard.
Yeah. Maybe he ages like whatever Yoda is.
Yeah.
When he's 700, he'll be like, oh shit.
He just turns into a little
Looks
green
so good, head. You will not. he just turns into a Yoda. We finally figured out what Yoda is. He's a fucking Wookiee.
he's a Wookiee.
Or he's like
the Men in Black, the little dude who like lives inside the old man.
Yeah,
exactly. He's just that's what happens when Yoda hits 1,000. He needs to like get inside a mech suit.
Yeah, he gets a full on mech. Hey, by the way, back to Mega Man X really quick. Oh, fucking mech suit.
Yep. Oh, have you seen the Ego Raptor video, the sequelitis?
Yes, that's what really got me to play it. I think that's what really got me to play it. Is I was considering it, and I was like, I think I've played like the first level a couple times before, and I just never really stuck with me. But then like I watched Sequelitis, and like I was like, oh shit! If someone loves this game that much, like I should just give it a shot. And I'm glad that I did. It's really great.
Like yeah, like you said, Mega Man's my favorite IP. I don't think there's one that I've played that I didn't enjoy, but X is probably, I think it's number two in terms of like my favorite series in the franchise. Battle Network just held a special place in my heart. It's going to be number one for a very long time.
I've never played a Battle Network.
Highly recommend weird. Battle Network. They are, I mean, it's an RPG. Like,
yeah.
It's actually more like an RPG than any other Mega Man kind of, like, X and Mega Man are action platformers.
Sure. This Maybe is I'm just a purist.
I think you should try it. You might not like the first one, but obviously you should play the first one if you're gonna give them a chance. Because there is actually a storyline involved in all of them. You could play them kind of out of order if you wanted. It's not that big of a difference, but basically, every time you go from like 1 to 2, just like there are changes to kind of make things better. So you don't want to go from 6 to 1 because 6 is just, I don't know, I loved 6. I'm not trying to remember, 4 or 5 would be my favorite, but 6, I bawled like a baby at the end of 6 because it was over. Like, that was why I cried.
Yeah, dude. It's always hard when, like, something you really love just, like, fucking ends. And you're just like, no. Yeah. It's over. And there's always, like, this weird feeling of, like, loss. It's like, you actually have to, like, grieve and, like, go through, like, the seven, like, the five steps of grief or whatever.
Yeah, well, I mean, for me, especially when it comes to RPGs, because that's my jam. Like, they've always been my favorite genre. I get emotionally invested if there's a good story, characters that I really like. So when they come to an end, like, it's like a movie. Like, you get that resolution, or, like, one of your favorite characters, say they die. Like, if I play Fire Emblem and a character I really like dies, I get pissed.
Totally.
Not to the point where I reset the game, because I like to play them like a purist.
Yeah.
But, I've had times where it's like I felt crushed when a character died, because it's especially in Fire Emblem, because it's your fault, unless you get like a random crit by 1%. But it's like, you generally put yourself in a position where bad things could happen. Mm-hmm. And I get salty. Like, if when I lose in Smash, when I shouldn't lose in Smash, you'll see how upset I get with myself. Mm-hmm. Because I put myself in that position, and I'm very hard on myself.
Sure.
And in Fire Emblem, it's the same way.
I think you just got that competitive spirit, like
It's
like I get the same way. Like, I think I got better with it when I used to play like the Pokemon trading card game, but like when I made like a mistake or like something just like didn't go my way and like something that was out of my control completely, I would get like super like mad. But like if I just legitimately got beat, like I would always be okay with that. Like, if I just like lost because the other guy was better or whatever, I'd be like, I mean, that sucks. Things could have went differently. That's fine. But like, if I made a mistake or if it was just something out of my control, I just
I'm definitely the same way. In fact, that happened to me a little bit yesterday, but more so last weekend. We had our big monthly, and I lost a crucial set because of a mental error. And
those are the worst.
Yeah, it was like, oh, this hitbox is done. Let me drop my shield and die because the hitbox wasn't done. And I sat there afterwards, and I got it. I always get in my own head whether I win or lose.
Yeah.
Because I am a very competitive guy.
Yeah.
And sometimes it sucks. I don't mind losing. Like, if anything, I've been told in terms of like play style, like a lot of my friends think I should be doing a lot better at tournaments than I do. I am incredibly hard on myself. I think there's a long way for me to go before I'm at the level that I want to be at. Granted, the bar that I've set for myself is incredibly high. And
naturally,
when I hit it, I'll raise the bar even higher.
And I'm the exact same way. I mean, like,
and until I get to a point where I feel like I've hit my peak, which I refuse to think I ever do. I'm always going to be hard on myself. And if I ever do hit that point where, if you follow Smash Brothers at all, in Smash Bros, like for Wii U, we have a player named Zero who's the best, like, and it's not close. If I was ever that level of good where I'm beating everybody, I think I'd stop playing, because the thrill of the competition is really big for me. There's actually, I'll tell you guys a little story.
Go for it. Spin that yarn.
Our number one player in BC, arguably one of the best, if not the best player in Canada, his name's Dawson. He goes by the handle Big D. He can play everybody. And in Project M and in Smash Brothers 4, there is a guy by the tag of TK Breezy. He's mostly known as a commentator. His actual playing career never really took off. He's like the chillin' dude of Smash 4. And he's a streamer now. He basically quit his job, became a full-time streamer. And the other day on his stream, he was talking about how he felt like he was the best Wii Fit trainer in Smash 4.
Yes, you told me that story.
Whether or not that's true, I don't know, because like there really aren't any Wii Fit trainers in the community. And so Dawson was like, I'll play you in a Ditto, because apparently TK claimed that if he lost a ditto of Wii Fit Trainer, he'd drop his color and pick up a new one, or the character or something. I don't fully remember it. And TK was like, no, I'm not going to play you because you're not subscribed to me on Twitch. And my initial thought process was like, are you kidding me? Like, how is
you scared?
That even a thing? Like, regardless of whether or not he's scared, and he probably is.
Yeah, sure.
Why should I have to pay money just to play you? There is the guy who came second at Apex this January. His name is DeBuzz. He was streaming, I don't know, a couple of months ago, and Dawson went up against him, lost, no big deal. And our buddy Brian happened to be in the stream because he was like, hey, I'm playing DeBuzz, come watch. And then he signed up to play DeBuzz too, and he's just like, yeah, absolutely, I'll play anybody, just sign up on the list. This is the number two guy at Apex, and he's not like, no, I'm only going to play if you pay me. Like, how do you lose your competitive spirit to the point where a $2.50 profit is what it's going to take for me to play you? Because let's be honest, there's no long-term commitment there for a lot of these people. If you like TK Breezy, you're going to stay subscribed to him. But if I'm only there to play you,
yeah,
you get 1 month of subscription and you make $2.50 off it. Like, what? There were people who were subscribers, like, hey, we don't really want to play you right now. We'll give Big D our spot. He's like, no, it doesn't work that way.
Sure.
You have to pay me to play me. And it's just like, dude, don't call us childish.
Yeah.
We're trying to come in here and be like, hey, we'll play you and we'll body you.
Right. He's like, Didn't he offer to donate too or something?
Yeah, people offered to donate like 10 bucks, and they're like, no, that's not the way it works here.
Whatever.
So, hashtag scurred.
That guy sounds like he sucks. I don't like him.
I don't like that mentality.
You
and I have been through similar things in the
Sure, yeah, community. Absolutely, we have.
But the whole concept of entitlement where you think you're that good or that important, the only way that I will have the honor of playing against you is if I give you my money. Like, come on, dude.
See, you know what the thing is? I know I'm that good and that great and the best, and it is an honor to play me in anything, but I also know that no one will do that.
I wouldn't care if people do it. Like,
honestly, I just want to do whatever is a good time.
Yeah, like, I'm building a computer at the moment, and I want to get a capture card, because I'm big in the Smash community, I'll stream it. I don't care if I have 10,000 people watching me and like 6,000 of them are subscribers. Like, if I'm at that point, fantastic. But if some dude comes in and is like, hey, I want to play you. Sweet dude, let's play.
Go for it. Yeah.
Like, unless I'm about to log off or like I have too many people on my list to play me, I'm never going to be like, nah, dude, give me money.
Yeah, that's true.
If you're giving me your time and like you value me enough that you want to play me, absolutely, let's do it.
Just you're there watching, that's enough for me.
Exactly.
I actually watched like a Smash stream a little while ago. This is a white dude in Japan. I forget what his like name was, like something Gaijin or something like that. And his main was like Mario.
Dude, Mario is solid in this game.
It was really cool. His stream was a really fun watch.
Yeah, and there are a lot of Smash streamers, whether it's Melee, I don't know if there are a lot of Project Ember Brawl streams, but I know Smash 4 has some. Mm. And a lot of them are really entertaining. Regardless of if they're a big channel or not, occasionally I'll go into Shofu's stream because some janky stuff. The first time he played against Custom Donkey Kong was hilarious. I think he rage quit his own stream.
Fantastic.
Custom Donkey Kong is stupid. He is the avatar. Like, His up B has this wind box. It basically just sucks you in. And if you don't time anything right, you can just be thrown off the stage and there's nothing you can do about it. And
that's
it's
fantastic.
Just spammable. Down B slaps. He just starts – he basically becomes in a volcano and there's like fire erupting from the ground.
What the fuck?
His B – like his new – like his big old monkey punch.
Yeah.
It the longer you charge it, the more of like this tornado wind box comes up. So you can actually just like push somebody off the map without even being close to them.
Sounds great.
And his side B just like it's like Earth.
You
just,
teach
like,
me how to do this.
It's just a custom. Like I couldn't unlock them for you. There are ways. Like you have a power save, right?
What?
Save through the 3DS.
Yeah.
Do you actually have the 3DS version of the game?
Yeah, Lloyd got it for me for being such a good dad.
The physical version or the digital version?
Physical.
Then you could technically download all of the approved custom sets that they're going to use Evo, and then you can transfer them onto your Wii U. I can like walk you through it.
That sounds great.
And then you get to just play around with all the janky stuff like Avatar Dong, and it's amazing.
I want to do this. This sounds fantastic. Can I make Little Mac good?
No, because Little Mac sucks. No, I don't know what Little Mac's customs are. Right. There's only like one Little Mac player that I know of. He's an Alberta guy named Alphakins. He's decent. He's the best player in Alberta. Uh-huh. But
can Duck Hunt be good?
I don't know if Duck Hunt's bad per se.
Sure.
Duck Hunt's biggest problems are like
that he's a dog.
How do you kill with this character? He can rack up damage, but no kill moves. I know at Apex, there's a guy. His name's MVD, I believe his tag is.
Sure.
Who plays Duck Hunt? He's a top player. So there are people who play Duck Hunt.
Yeah.
I could never help you with that character. I've played it once. I know what the moves do, and that's about it.
Sure. I still have to unlock everyone on my on the Wii version.
It's easy.
I've been playing it into
like a one-stock game with a computer, and you just pick a fastball like Captain Falcon. You just Falcon kick off the ledge and just do it until you unlock someone.
Yeah, smart. Hey, what's your favorite Star Wars game? Is it Battlefront?
No.
No. What is it?
KOTOR.
KOTOR.
Knights of the Old Republic.
That's fair. Guess what? That's another game I've never played. Boom. That's not true.
Actually, a buddy of mine was talking about this last night. The original, he's like, I've wanted to get into it, and I can't. It's like it didn't age well. The mechanics are janky. Look, this is the one time in the world you're ever going to hear me say it. Play the mobile version. Because they remade it for mobile games in mind. As a mobile game, it's probably better than it would be as like trying to play it on the PC version.
Sure. I mean, I have it on Steam now because of
age well. Let's be honest, that game didn't age well in a PC standpoint. It's an old game. It's fantastic.
Yeah, it is.
I've
tried playing it a couple times and I get like so far and then I just stop and then I go like, do I really want to go back to it? I think if I just push through, I would probably enjoy it. But it's something I haven't played. Speaking of mobile, do you play any mobile games at all?
No.
No?
I'm a gamer. No, we're not getting into that topic. No, I just, a lot of them I just don't have any interest in.
This shit's my jam right here.
SimCity
build it! Let's go. Dude, I'm a level 25. I got 158,000 people in my city right now.
Now here's a question for you.
Sure.
Is there a limit to what you can do because you have these massive time frames to build something? Is it one of those kind of games, like, say, Clash of Clans, where you get to a point where it's like, oh, yeah, I'll build this building, but it takes 12 hours to complete.
No.
And there's only so much I can do. Like, that's why I'm not a big mobile gamer. It's like, I understand that they're kind of more geared towards casual things you can do when you're at work or on the bus.
Something that you can spend like 5 minutes doing and go, okay, I'll set everything up and then I gotta do
exactly
things.
I
can actually sit and play SimCity for like an hour or so if I really wanted to, because like when you build a building, it like builds, but then you can like upgrade it and you have to like there is like a waiting thing where you have to like build things to like upgrade your buildings, but or, like, mix those things to make different items or whatever. But there's also a market
Okay.
So I could go in and just buy whatever I want to build, to upgrade stuff, and then also sell, and you can play the market that way. There's a max thing you can sell stuff at, so things don't get super inflated. So, like, you could just do that, like, the whole time, and, like, you could just keep playing on and on. Okay. The early game is really hard because it will go, all right, here, now you need to build this thing. And you're like, fuck, I didn't save any money. And then you have to make a whole bunch of money, and that can take a while. But, like, once you, like, get past that hurdle and you kind of get used to how the game plays, you can really just sit there and play for a while. And
I played Flappy Bird. Does that count?
You still have Flappy Bird on your phone?
I have something that is, in my opinion, way better. I have Flappy Nyan on my phone, and it's Nyan Cat.
Nice.
And my Nyan Cat is in a Yoda costume, and
beautiful.
Basically, when I'm at work and I go to the bathroom, I play some Flappy Nyan.
Nice. The only other mobile game right now that I truly am in love with is called 8-Bit Doves. And basically, it's you tap either side of the phone, and the guy flies that way or that way. And the soundtrack is like one song, but it's beautiful. I could listen to it forever. And its art style is like Game Boy. So it's like two-tone. The back is like the gray-green, and then your pixels. But it's done really well, and it looks really pretty. And it's addictive.
There's two main gripes I have with mobile gaming, and they're the reasons that I don't play them. The first is that Clash of Clans style model where it's like you go on, you play it for like 2 minutes,
and
then
you're
done. And then it's like, okay, I'll play again tomorrow.
Yeah, fuck
that. The other is microtransactions, because mobile games are the worst. I've seen stories all the time of like little kids who, without even knowing it, run this like ridiculous bill for their parents, like $6,000 on one game.
Holy shit.
Like, what the hell is this? And I have a problem with microtransactions.
I don't mind microtransactions, except for when, because there are mobile games out there where you get to a point where it's like, okay, you're at this wall, and to get past this wall is that you have to spend real money. And that's what's bullshit. And that's why
I like
SimCity
like
Build It, because I'd
like
never reach that point.
Temple Run, it's like, oh, you've died too many times. Pay money to play again. Like,
fuck that. That's stupid.
Like, I understand that in an arcade where it's like you put in a quarter and you play like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles and then you die and then you put in another quarter. Like, that's fine. But, like, I don't know.
It's very different. Not on a mobile game.
Because maybe I'm just a purist. It's just, if I'm going to pay that like that quarter per life, I want it to be in an arcade in that kind of setting. Because then I'm just in that mentality of, I know that that's what I'm going to be doing.
Yeah, you came to pay.
I came to pay. Yeah. Whereas Temple Run, you die X number of times. And it's like, okay, now you have to pay.
I'm gonna beat
like,
the Simpsons.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Hey, do you want to talk about a real game?
Before we do that, there's something that I think you would love. And
it's
going
on
my work right now. Because I work in a video game / very nerdy themed restaurant.
Yes,
they've been running machete order all weekend.
Oh, really?
Like legit machete order, it's fantastic.
Yes.
And on some of the TV, like not every TV is playing Star Wars, but there's always Star Wars content. So what they were doing was they played the original animated series of the Clone Wars.
I never saw that.
I've seen most of it. It's good.
Yeah.
I don't know if they did the new one that you and I really got into, or Rebels or anything like that. But they had on Saturday just cut scenes from every Star Wars game just going. So it was like, it's like The Force Unleashed. They did the Old Republic cutscenes. Like I remember, like every time I looked out, there's just Starkiller doing his thing, and it's just like Mike would love this.
I did not mention. I'm glad you brought that up, because I didn't mention the thing that I talked to you about. My favorite Star Wars game is easily The Force Unleashed. I love it. Starkiller is my like. Oh man, he might be my favorite Star Wars character of all time. Like, I love him in his whole story, like, with all my heart. I wish, dude, I wish I could marry him. I wish I could be him. I want to be inside
Darth
him.
Revan. Darth Revan.
Sure.
One of the greatest characters, in my opinion, in any story arc ever. Like, that man did ridiculous things to everyone.
Yes.
And then apparently they're bringing him back to the Old Republic. And that is a game that I am legitimately sad that they've kind of run into the ground.
I think they're coming out with new stuff for it.
They just announced, or they've just released, I don't know which, but the next expansion is all about Darth Revan and like this, he's bringing back this empire. And
ooh, spooky.
It seems cool, but at the same time, I have to remember that it's the Old Republic, and like the model is just horrible now, so I can't play it. I had a lot of fun with that game when it first came out, and then they ran into the problem of, oh crap, everybody loved this game too much and got max level faster than we were expecting. We have nothing for them to do.
Oh man, I wish I would have subscribed to that game right when it came out, because I feel like I probably would have been like you, just ran through it. Because I really did like it, but something I'm
You and I played the beta together.
Yeah, we did. That was fun.
We did some crazy Sith things. Yeah, we both did. Made Darth Mauls.
Dude, yeah. I think I might go back to that game and give it another whirl.
You know what? If you go back to that game and give it a whirl, I'll play with you.
Ooh, let's record it.
Well, we'll record it for the YoFizz YouTube channel.
Hey, buddy. Thank you.
Maybe I'll put it on mine, because I technically made one when I made my new tag. Because, like, let's be honest, if you're going to do it, you might as well get the name everywhere. Yep,
exactly.
Except for YouTube, because YouTube's new policy
is
here.
God, fuck YouTube.
I mean, to be fair, you can kind of, like, save the username.
Yes.
It's just the channel that you can't get, which I'm okay with to an extent. Yeah. Because I don't want some random dude picking up my moniker and then, like, never using it. And then it just kind of gives them a fail-safe for... Look at a guy like Jesse Cox, who originally his handle was OMFG Kata, because he was on the One Moderately Funny Gamer kind of network. Sure. And he did Cataclysm, like, beta stuff. That was how he started out. And now he's a Let's Player, so he's gotten it so he can actually have his YouTube URL to be youtube.com/JesseCox. I think if you still do youtube.com/OMFGCata, it's the same thing. And I'm actually okay with that whole kind of concept. It's kind of annoying if you want to start a YouTube channel. It's
super annoying, because I just recently started over, but it appears that they kind of broke the rules for me, because I didn't. They have, like, things you have to do this and this to be able to get your custom URL. And basically, I think what happened was I got a lot of subscribers in a short period of time, and they were like, oh yeah, dude, you're fine.
Oh, so you actually have youtube.com/YoFizz now?
Yep. I'd like to change it to YoFizzYT at this point, just because to match everything else.
I think that is one time that it's okay to have things that are a little bit mismatched. Like, it's not like you are YoFizz on YouTube and then your Twitch is like, I like Star Wars 987.
Like, yeah, it's close enough.
It's like me. The only thing that I'm not Enigma SSB is Nintendo, where I have SSB Enigma. And it's one of those things where if you really have an issue with that, you're being a little bit too nitpicky for my taste anyway.
Sure. It's just like everything I have is YoFizzYT, except for YouTube at this point.
I mean, the YT is YouTube, so.
Or is
it really
YoTube?
Matter? Also, because I'm looking at this background, is this like the Rocco's Modern Life background, and you just put your logo on it? Because that's what it reminds me of.
No, but it's close to it. I got it from like a 90s. This website has like a whole bunch of like 90s themed free backgrounds.
It's the first thing I thought of was Rocco's Modern Life. It's obviously 90s themed, which I'm okay with.
Sure. It's originally pink. The gray, where the gray is, it was
pink.
Oh,
yeah.
And so if you do that, it looks a lot like Saved by the Bell.
Oh, that too. I love Saved by the
Bell. Yep. Starkiller. I hope they make another one of those games.
Force Unleashed?
Yes. I don't think they ever will.
I don't know what happens in the second one, so I don't know if, like, story-wise they can.
There's two endings.
Which story-wise they can. Canon ended.
They what?
Like, it's like, does he die?
No.
Oh, okay.
You should play it. It's insanely short. You'll finish it in about
five hours. I never played it. Is the big thing? I guess I could do it now because it's obviously not a full price game. But when it
you
should have
got it when it was Star Wars Humble Bundle. I think it was in there.
I didn't have any money.
Oh, that's true.
The bundle.
Yeah, I should have gifted you it.
You already gifted me a Humble Bundle like 2 years ago.
That's true.
It was
my
birthday gift.
But I mean, like, but to be fair, like, oh, what did I really spend? Like $6.01.
Something like that.
Actually, it might have been more expensive. More expensive.
It was probably if you unlocked it for everything, it was probably like $12 or something.
Yeah. Whatever, it's worth it.
I mean, the Humble Bundle's great.
Yeah,
love
the Humble.
Anybody out there watching has never gotten a Humble Bundle, go to
HumbleBundle.com. Subscribe, get their shit emailed to you. Don't miss a single one.
Find out, because they do weekly bundles. They do, I think they do like ebook bundles and stuff now too. Music bundles maybe. All the time they have bundles going on, and they actually have their own store.
Flash game bundle, mobile bundle.
So if you like check out their store, you might find a deal that's different from Steam or GOG.com or any of the other online marketplaces. But the actual Humble Bundles that they do are phenomenal. They just did one for Origin, and I think right now they're doing a Might and Magic one.
Yep.
So if you're into the Heroes of Might and Magic kind of series, not in just the Heroes, because I believe they do Dark Messiah of Might and Magic is in this one, and Might and Magic, A Clash of Heroes is in this one, all the time. And it's pay what you want, and then there are certain thresholds, or if you pay above the average, you get extra games. And then they also release it with, like, if you pay more than this much, you unlock the next tier, which sometimes includes swag, like t-shirts or the official soundtracks. Generally, the official soundtracks, especially in the indie ones, are included, which is awesome. I've actually gotten some really sweet ones because indie games have awesome music sometimes.
Yeah, right now, the Might and Magic bundle, if you pay $15 or more, you unlock, like, four plus four. Like, you get like 14 things at least.
Yeah, because they generally add things during the run of them as well. In fact, the one that you bought me, Mike, I actually went back to after I bought another Humble Bundle, I think like 6 months later, and I realized they added like more games to it. So I actually got more out of yours than I was expecting.
Yeah, buddy. Suck it. Friendship.
Yeah.
I mean, I got like, yeah, buddy.
Probably a really bad heart, but there you go.
Yeah, what are you gonna do? I got a like a good one with like Guacamelee and like some other like really good.
Yeah, I didn't get that one because like I already had almost everything on it. Like it was just Guacamelee that I didn't have. It was like, eh.
Yeah,
I can just buy that one when it goes on sale for $1. Like I don't need to pay like a penny for it because I don't mind paying money for it because it does go to charity.
Yeah. Oh, the other cool thing about Humble Bundle is you can split up where the money goes.
Yeah,
that's true. You can make it all go to charity. You can give some to the developers, and then to the Humble Bundle people.
There has to be a minimum to how much goes to where.
No, you can make it all go to charity if you want.
Oh,
they have like a suggested thing to do, and then here I'm gonna see if I can just.
I generally just kind of leave it the way it is, and I let them split it up. If anything, like I would add like some extra money to charity.
Right, that's what I do.
But
like,
I
they have
never,
like a slide bar, and then I will never go,
like, oh, I'm gonna just screw over the developers or the Humble Bundle staff.
Yeah,
like I'll put an extra if I want to give $3 more to charity. I'll just add $3 to it. Like,
yeah,
care.
That's fair. I usually what I do is like I have like a tier system in my head. I was like, I want most of it to go to charity, then developer second, and then the Humble Bundle people.
But to be fair, that's the way they set it up too.
Yeah, they do.
Which is why I'm overall okay with their breakdowns.
Yeah.
Because they're fair.
They are.
It's like 60, 30, 10 or something like that, if it's that.
Yes. I fucking love Humble Bundle. So great. Hey.
Rules.
How about a real video game?
Sure.
Yooka-Laylee.
Okay. Let's
Oh, I had a segue for that and I forgot it. It was pre-written and everything. Rewind. Hey Jake, what's your favorite instrument?
Is it a ukulele?
No. You're just trying to play into it now. Yooka-Laylee was a Kickstarter. Guess how much money they have.
Still is a Kickstarter.
Yeah, still is.
I'm actually looking
at 43 days left. They have over $2 million pledged. Their goal was
the conversion is? Yeah, it's currently at $2.12 million. By the time this thing goes down, like in 43 days, I will not be surprised if it becomes the highest backed Kickstarter project ever, beating out the Double Fine stuff as well as the Ouya.
Oh God, the Ouya.
Yeah, there's something you haven't talked about in a while.
Hey, we used to remember how highly we used to speak of the Ouya.
My thing with Ouya was always that I wanted to see kind of how it worked before I enjoy the concept behind it, right. Of it being this really cheap kind of console that you get a lot of free games.
Emulation machine.
Yeah, it's an emulation machine. That's exactly what it is, right?
Yeah.
I thought it was a cool project. I don't remember if I was like super hyped for it. If I was, it was probably unnecessarily so. But the actual concept of this $100 emulation machine is cool. I enjoy it.
Yeah.
I
have an Ouya.
Do you have it, or does the girlfriend still have it?
Well, technically, it's my brother's. My brother loaned it out to my girlfriend, and it's at her house.
I remember her getting that like a year ago. Does she even use it?
We've been borrowing it for a very long time. She has. I've probably used it at her house more than she has. I think she maybe started Earthbound on it or something. But
I think it's an actual emulation machine. Yeah, I was about to say she was Earthbound, and then I realized she's not talking about the like $200 cartridge.
Ew.
I'm gonna buy that one day.
Oh, I hope so. But I hope it's like pocket change to you when you do it. You're just like, oh, $200? Nah.
No. I'm going to find this. Like, my goal is to find this jank at like a flea market for $2 and not have like the person know what they have.
Yeah.
And it's just like, oh.
Oh, dude, Earthbound. I remember this piece of garbage. $2? Yeah. I guess I'll take it.
Like, I want some legit game chaser moments. Also,
I have.
If you haven't checked out the Game Chasers, you should check out the Game Chasers. It's a great channel.
I will check it out. I'm actually writing it down right now in my.
It's if you watch like American Pick'ems or anything, like
sure.
They go to flea
markets
and stuff, and they look for video games, and they've actually had some ridiculous finds. And I think now they're on like season 4 or season 5.
Is that just like a YouTube channel?
Yeah.
I'll check it out.
And their production quality started out so bad. It was awesome. Like,
are they up to like TV quality now?
They always like end product. You could be like, oh, this could have been on TV.
Sure.
But like their actual equipment, like their lighting is just like a lamp with like a garbage bag on it.
It's some guy with a flashlight on a pole.
Used to just be like a poster board that they just like taped to the wall. They like.
Fantastic.
They found there's actually an episode where they find a tripod for a camera, and it's like it's like in rough shape, and like it's still better than the one we have. The one we have is like held together with like gum and like duct tape and like thumbtacks. It's like hilarious. And I think now they actually have like a Patreon page, so they actually get support.
Good for them.
So like the quality's always been good, but it's actually much more professionally approached now.
That's cool.
The two guys who do it are hilarious, and like they're from Texas, and it's some of the things they find is unreal. And they actually do a lot of collaborations with a lot of the other retro game kind of community.
Okay.
So if you've ever heard of a guy named Pat the NES Punk, who's a little big on YouTube,
sure.
they do stuff with him. And yeah, I recommend it. It's one of the few YouTube channels that I follow religiously.
Ooh.
Like, when they put out a video, it's not like when Fizzy Stardust uploaded a Pokemon battle once every 3 months.
Who is
and
that?
You're just like, ah, it's there. I'll watch it eventually. I watch that. The second right. I see it in my sub box.
I don't know who that is. I don't get the reference.
probably not. He hasn't been a winner since 2007.
That's fair. A few years ago, I was at like a flea market, and I bought an Atari for like $20. And he's like, yeah, dude, it works. Sure, it's fine. I've not played it. I've not hooked it up because it's missing the AC cord. It had some other random AC cord in there that just didn't match up. Like, what the fuck? But I have like a
crap. I guess it's one of those things you do have to kind of know what you're getting. Before
yeah,
you
I know. I really didn't. I just saw it and I was like, I want this. I like looked and I was like, it looks like there's cables. There's game pads. There's a fucking shit ton of games. Close it back up, I'll take it. I have no idea what any of that is worth. I just know the Atari itself isn't worth much because it's one of the more
common for the most ones. Part Atari isn't yeah. worth a ton. It's I don't know Atari price values
yeah.
too much.
I don't even remember what's in there. I think
but
I
mean
Donkey
you're not gonna be getting you might be able to like make at most an extra $10 off it. Like that's
yeah.
that's all I feel like you're gonna
yeah.
get.
I mean, I don't feel like I'm gonna. I'm sitting on a gold mine or anything, but it's
oh,
probably
God, yeah. Like,
it's probably more
money,
than I would expect.
You want to know where the real money is? The real money's in the NES and the Super NES. Like
yes.
that's where the money is.
Yep.
You find yourself like an Action 52 cart or like the World Championship carts. I brought up Pat the NES Punk. He was on.
Yep.
He went on Pawn Stars. I feel like they just invited him in because they kind of knew what he had.
Sure.
And he basically had two copies of the NES World Championship cartridge, the gold one and the silver one. And he was asking for $35,000 for them, which is about accurate price point. Like, it's not like he had
yeah.
this unrealistic value on them.
Right.
I don't think he ever would have sold them, even if they offered it to him. Like, I think he was just legitimately invited onto the show to show
yeah,
off
just
these
so they could,
incredibly
yeah.
rare cartridges.
Yeah.
They
needed an episode.
Yeah, they put it into an episode. And because all of those shows are fake.
Yes.
All of those, like, Storage Wars and, like, Pawn Stars and crap.
I love Storage Wars so much.
But it's
so,
so bad. So fucking much. No. So
it's
bad.
So good. I love it.
It's so fake.
I don't care.
I know the people who like legitimately like did those kind of like the Storage Ward kind of buy
yeah.
out the old unit and find stuff.
Yeah,
they were pissed when those shows came out.
Sure,
like you just like ruined our business. Not that they would generally make a ton of money because they'd
yeah.
be like, oh, maybe once every 100 units you find some really cool stuff.
Yes.
But I mean,
now you have a whole bunch of dickheads with extra time.
Exactly.
On your territory. Yeah. But I don't care. I love cheesy things. Like, the more cheese, the better.
They just did one not too long ago. And it was, they found a bunch of NES stuff and they took it into a store.
Yeah.
First of all, the people who ran that store are retarded.
Sure.
Because they didn't really like they had some games in there. Like there were some decent games in there.
Yeah.
But one of the games that they found, which they thought was a rare game, was the European version of the game, which isn't that rare. It's like maybe worth $30 as opposed to $300.
Yeah.
And like then you've got the gambler, the
yes!
the top. I'm just trying to make
tank top
like,
time.
Entertaining to, yeah. It's like, we'll flip you for it. If we win, you pay us $5,000, and if you win, you'll get it for $5. It's like, first of all, you don't have anywhere close. Like, if they even agreed to that, which I would imagine they would never do,
right?
They would lose so much money.
Yeah,
like, I don't think they could have made money off of things at the $2,000 price point.
Yeah,
like I think at $1,500, they could then turn around and make some sort of retail profit on it, but. Five, come on.
Yeah.
Like,
love the gambler. Yeah. You're on the same page as me. You love that
show.
There is another episode where something very similar happened. Is one of the newer dudes bought a unit with an NES. It had the box, but it wasn't sealed or anything like that. It just happened to have the box with it. And he's like, "This is worth thousands!" Like, very adamant about it. And he took it into a game shop, and it didn't work.
The guy was like, "I'll give you $100 for it?" Like,
no, it's... it didn't even work. He's like, "It's worth nothing. It's worthless." And he's like, if it were, like, a first run, like one of the first made, I guess, he would have been like, "It's worth something," but it was just not. And it was whatever.
But yeah, it's a box. Yes, I think for the most part, like even paying retail, you should be able to get for about $100.
Yeah.
Obviously, not like the first runs. I would imagine if you like a first edition NES, it's going to be worth a little bit more money.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know. People seem to think that old games just mean more money.
They don't. I have a whole case of them there, and they're worthless.
I
don't know how much Zelda's worth, but it's probably worth, like, I don't know, $10.
Like the gold cart one?
Yeah.
Yeah, something about that. Like, for the most part, I know for me, my price point is generally 2 to 5 per cartridge is what I'm willing to spend. Mm-hmm. Keep in mind, most of that's going to be at, like, a flea market or a thrift shop or something along those lines. With the rare games, it's like, okay, I'll pay the extra money. But if I had every game, I know, again, we'll go back to Pat the NES Punk. He has, I believe, every game in the NES library.
That's insane.
And he does a podcast, and I think he said it worked out to taking out the really rare stuff. His collection, he probably aimed to pay 2 to 5 a cartridge. Mm-hmm. And a lot of them was just he bought in bulk, so they became less and less and less overall. And that, I mean, the fact that he has every NES game, if he does, I don't know if he has them all or just like the NA library.
Yeah.
It's nuts.
Yeah, like, that's insane.
It's an entire wall of just NES cartridges.
There's so many NES games.
Amazing.
Yeah.
I want it one day.
I think I do have like a 30-hour game in there somewhere, but I don't remember what it was. I just remember I had someone who wanted to buy a few games, and I was like, yeah, I could maybe sell you some. But I don't think it ever panned out. Or maybe it did. I don't remember. Maybe I got money.
I will pay for your games in all dress chips.
Oh, that's tempting. That's really tempting.
Yeah, it is.
We'll see. We'll talk.
we'll
keep
that
in touch. Yooka-Laylee!
Yeah, we went off topic on that one.
Yes. How did we even... from Yooka-Laylee to all dress chips. Yooka-Laylee. It actually got like 8 more donations by the... 10 more backers by the in that duration of conversation we just had. You were very high on Yooka-Laylee. You just said that it could be have the most money backed.
Well, I don't think that's unreasonable to think. Yeah,
I don't think so either. They just added a new
stretch goal.
Yes, and I think they already made it, but
probably. I'm just like I'm looking at their their level of pledges.
Yeah,
they have sold out of all 10 of their like second highest pledges, which is like £3,400.
Yeah,
10 people have like $5,300. 10 are like that's incredible.
Yep.
This came out, like, 2 days ago.
Mm-hmm. It is very, very new. Yeah.
Those of you who have no idea what Yooka-Laylee is.
Yeah, tell them about it.
Yooka-Laylee is a 3D platformer.
It's a buddy cop.
Done by the guys who... They used to work for a little company called Rare, and they worked on a series called Banjo-Kazooie. If you grew up in the 90s, you will know what Rare is.
Remember how I never play any good games? Never played Banjo-Kazooie. Not a single one.
Again, two games I almost bought a week ago, complete in box, Banjo-Kazooie and Banjo-Tooie, and the asshole didn't reply to my comment and sold it to somebody who had messaged him after me. I was mad. But yeah, if you grew up in the 90s, you will know of Rare. In fact, on the Super Nintendo and into the N64, they were the juggernauts. They were probably the best video game developer in the world. They did Killer Instinct. They did, going into the Super Nintendo era, they did Banjo-Kazooie. They did Diddy Kong Racing. They were the guys behind Perfect Dark. They also did a little game called Conker's Bad Fur Day, which did a GoldenEye.
Yes.
They were huge. And then Microsoft bought them out, and they started making Kinect games.
Yes, the best series of all time, Kinect Sports.
Yep. So Yooka-Laylee is...
People like that game.
Viva Pinata. I never watched the show, but that's the only reason I know of.
That's
of
fair. They made a game and people really liked it. I think it got some pretty good, decent scores and stuff. But yeah, Rare.
But yeah, Yooka-Laylee is the spiritual successor to Banjo Kazooie in every way. Like if you just... Banjo Kazooie, instruments. Yooka-Laylee, instrument. I believe.
Oh my God, Banjo.
Yeah.
I'm so sorry. Just kidding. Oh my God, Kazoo! That one's legitimate.
Oh my God.
Oh, that that one's legitimate. Sorry. Kazoo! Oh.
Nice.
That one was. Yeah. I legit just got that.
For Yooka-Laylee, I believe they're even actually getting the original composers. I think Grant Kirkhope is behind it.
It's somewhere on this page.
Yeah, Grant Kirkhope is. Yep. He did the original soundtrack on Banjo-Kazooie. He actually released that. It's on the Kickstarter page. Jungle World is the working title. Mm-hmm. You listen to it and you just hear the old Banjo-Kazooie, the Donkey Kong 64. Like, you got that really nostalgic feel. And obviously what they've shown is very early in development.
Yeah.
But it I'm excited for it. If it is the Banjo 3 we all deserve, then I will buy it without hesitation. The one thing I'm really interested in is the fact that it's going to be on consoles and PC.
Yeah.
Because for anyone who didn't... Well, because it's just interesting to see that, because you think of Banjo-Kazooie, that was a Nintendo exclusive. Like, that was back in the heyday of Nintendo, before the PlayStation and... Or PlayStation 2. PlayStation 1 was around. Definitely before the Xbox. And
yep.
They just owned everything. Like, Nintendo was a god. Like, Sega was there. They were just Dreamcast. Going downhill. Dreamcast was amazing.
I can burn games to my Dreamcast. It's great.
That was one of the many flaws of that console.
Back then, but now it's fantastic. I love it.
It was fantastic back then, too. Don't get me wrong.
Well, yeah, sure.
It's people like us were part of the reason that the Dreamcast failed. The other big one was EA, because they wouldn't back it with EA Sports.
Oh, but 2K was so much better.
Doesn't matter. EA sold more.
I know. Such a drag.
Just the way it is. But yeah, Yooka-Laylee looks great. It sounds great.
It's making millions.
It's awesome that it's going to be on everything, and it's going to be interesting to see. In my opinion, if anybody tries to pick up Playtonic as an exclusive, if, like, say Yooka-Laylee does really well, do one of the big companies be like, okay, we want you to make games just for us now?
Ooh.
Could you imagine, like, the Wii U suddenly becomes the home of Playtonic, and, like, Yooka-Laylee is... Like, I don't think they could do it with Yooka-Laylee. If you're going to release one on everything, you might as well continue to do so. But... Imagine they make more amazing.
Bayonetta 2.
Bayonetta 2 is kind of a freak of nature.
Yeah, but it happened.
They went to the point where, like, I'm still confused as to why Nintendo owns the rights to it. But
I don't know, but they do. It happened.
Hey, let's be honest. If it happens and all of a sudden I have the console that like I get to play the spiritual successor to Yooka-Laylee or to Banjo-Kazooie,
yeah,
and only I get to play it because screw PlayStation and screw the Xbox One.
Only you. You're the only one with a EU.
Yeah, only me. Only me. Let's do this.
Yeah.
No, only the Wii. Like, if it becomes a Wii exclusive, I'll be honest. The Wii U kind of needs some love at the moment. They had a fantastic 2014.
Yes.
They still have a good lineup for 2015. I'm super hyped for Fatal Frame. They still have Star Fox. I believe they're going to have to do another Metroid game. But they kind of went really quickly on all of their big IPs.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, they have Zelda, which is now going to come out in 2016.
Yeah.
So that's kind of nice. But it's like, how long can they stretch this? Because Nintendo isn't generally one to put out, aside from Mario, multiple games on the same console.
Sonic Boom 2. Let's go.
Oh, yes. Actually, I was so sad. My buddy was talking to me the other day about the cartoon.
Uh-huh.
And
like the original cartoon?
No, like the Sonic Boom cartoon.
Oh, there's a Sonic... I had no idea.
There's a Sonic Boom cartoon. I didn't know that either. And he thought that this was like the show's creator's choice, and it turns out it wasn't. I was heartbroken. But you know of the Knuckles jump glitch in Sonic Boom where you like jump and you pause, and then when you unpause, you can jump again?
No.
That was one of the main,
oh, man,
main things about that game is you could skip huge chunks of it because the invisible walls, they weren't like all the way up or down. Uh-huh. So you could use this jump glitch to just skip portions of the game.
Fantastic.
And in the show, somebody had done an edit where Knuckles just jumps, right?
Right.
And then they show a pause menu. And then they go back and they show a little bit more of them jumping and they show a pause menu. And my buddy thought that was the show, like the guys who did the show, just like kind of paying homage to the bug. Yeah. And it was actually just some fan-made thing. I was heartbroken because I thought that would have been the greatest thing ever in a TV show.
Would.
Where they acknowledge how bad the game is.
Yeah. I've seen a few like glitchy things. I mean, a few is being generous. I've seen a lot of glitchy
things.
The game's
more broken than Sonic 06.
Yes.
Sonic 06 at least was like entertaining in its bugs.
I mean, I didn't see... I didn't play... God, I haven't played a Sonic game since, like, Game Gear.
Sonic Adventure 2 Battle.
Sure. And so I've been, like, watching footage of some of the Sonic games. I'm just like, oh, this is what I've been missing.
They've been so bad. Like, Sonic Generations was really good.
That's what I hear.
They did a really good job of it.
Well, that one was the 360 one, right?
Yeah, it was on everything.
Oh, okay, sure.
It was the one where it was like half the game was the original like 2D Sonic, and the other half was like this the new age 3D Sonic. And the 3D worlds they did were actually really well done. Mm-hmm. And obviously the 2D stuff, like 2D Sonic, is still amazing. And it just felt so crisp and so good. And it was like the only good Sonic game in like the last 10 years.
I'm gonna try
that's kind of bad. I would recommend Generations to any Sonic fan if you haven't played it.
I'm gonna try it. I wanted Sonic Boom to be good. It was like the type of game that I would maybe enjoy.
I never would have wanted it to be good just because of the like Knuckles model. Like
he looks weird.
He's just like, I'm on roids now. I'm Mega Swampert.
Not even close. Mega Swampert is a beast.
Mega Swampert kind of close to new Knuckles. Don't even.
But I played the demo of it the other day, and I was just like, I'm not having fun at all.
Yeah, like, that's the thing with, like, Sonic 06. Like, a lot of people are like, it's the worst game ever made. But I've played that game, and yes, some of the bugs are retarded. But I never didn't have fun in it because of how retarded it is, if that makes sense. Sense like it was so broken in the most fun, entertaining ways. That game
sense,
is just
yeah.
weird because it's got some really weird, like romantic stuff going on with a human and a hedgehog. But other than that, it's
great.
Not as bad as people think.
Yeah. All right. Fantastic. Yeah, I mean, do you want to say anything more about Yooka-Laylee other than it's just...
It's like, it's been around for 2 days. Like, what can we really say about Yooka-Laylee aside from the fact that it's getting a crap ton of money?
Yeah, it looks over 2 awesome, million.
And I'm super hyped for it. And if I had money that I was going to throw at a video game, because I don't normally do Kickstarters or Indiegogo or Patreon or anything like that.
I've only funded one project, and I was happy with it. And but it was for like a music Kickstarter thing, so it's a little bit different.
I mean, just in general, like the whole Kickstarter, Indiegogo kind of things. I don't ever want to throw money willy nilly. Mm-hmm. Something Yooka-Laylee is not something that I feel is just gonna crash, because you do hear things about Kickstarter projects that's like, oh, we funded this money 2 years ago. And there's no word.
It's funny you mentioned that. There is a game that I'm following in the shadows. I'm not donating a penny to it, but I want it to do really well. This guy has been making this game for 6 years, and he had like a game, and then he's all, "No, this looks like shit," and threw it out and started over with a new engine like that he's making on his own. Like
Diablo 3 did that. Diablo 3 was originally supposed to come out when I was still in elementary school. I remember hearing about them just canning that game, and then it came out whenever it was a couple years ago.
Other problem is this game is on Steam Early Access, and it's a wrestling game, and the only thing you can do is you can start a match with two people and you don't get to choose. You can punch, and you can suplex, and that's it.
Suplex city, bitch.
And then the game will randomly end and be like, all right, you can start over now if you want, but you can't quit. But I've been watching him make it.
I mean, if it's an early access game,
it's just...
Like, alpha is alpha, beta is beta. Like, you can't really judge a game based on that.
Yeah. But this is like
they're going to be buggy,
stuff.
And if it's you're not paying money for it either, it's even better. But
I'm waiting
like,
until there.
Unless you're
an
looking at
game.
Like say Minecraft, which for all intents and purposes, when it came out, yes, they continued to add things to it, but in its overall core, it hasn't changed too much.
Really.
Like it's always just been this kind of sandboxy world where you create the game itself.
Yeah.
So that was like the one time, aside from bugs, you could be like, okay, well, this is where my money got me. If your game's buggy in alpha, like, if you're getting judged for that, that's just dick move.
Sure.
And I would never judge a game based off its alpha if it was really buggy. Like, I played in, I got into the Heroes of the Storm beta when it first came out.
Nice.
Or actually, I got into the alpha. That's how long I've had that.
Wow. How is it?
I wouldn't know. Never played it. Actually, that's not true. I loaded it up once. I played one game, and I was like, not my thing.
Yeah.
It's just...
It seems like something that I might be able to get into, though.
It's very casual.
Exactly. That's my thing.
And it's not meant to be an e-sport. They're going to make it an e-sport because everything is being turned into
There are already teams.
They just did a collegiate series.
Yeah. Yeah,
there's the storm the dorm kind of thing,
yeah.
Which is like I'm okay with it. Like, you could technically turn any game into an esport. We even see it in the Smash community, where Melee, especially if you look at any of the big tournaments, it pushes in the top three on Twitch. I think it maybe overtook like League of Legends for like 20 minutes at Apex, maybe. But the second that Mango lost, like, viewers plummeted.
Yeah.
Part of it had to do with just the time, too. But generally, when Mango loses, people stop watching.
Yeah,
everyone
loves Mango.
There's no reason not to love
Mango.
I don't
really like how mangoes taste, so I don't get it.
Man. Mangoes put them on Cloud9. That's all you gotta know.
Yeah.
But, even Smash for Wii U, which... As somebody who loves the game, it's not always fun to watch, especially with a lot of characters. In fact, it can be pretty cancerous to watch. But they're still pushing to turn it into a quote-unquote e-sport.
Yeah.
So you could do it with Heroes of the Storm. Like,
Oh, yeah.
The fact that, like, you could turn, like, even Hearthstone into it. Like, how many people watch the, like, the Hearthstone World Championships for Fire Battle? Like, I did.
Lots. So many.
Like I did. To be fair, though,
I watch ESL every week.
Hearthstone's a great game to be, like, it's a great stream game.
Yeah, it is.
You just, like, you get more interaction. You kind of feel like, okay, this is what I would do.
Yeah.
And then if they do that, you're like,
Hell yeah.
You're
like on top tier. Oh, my God.
Yeah, like, me and Firebat, we're on the same page.
Yeah, dude. Me and Batsy, that's what I call him.
I mean, I showed up to his stream once. He said, hi, we're best friends.
Yeah, dude, we're bros.
But
me and Trump hang out on stream.
Oh, God. Okay. I have a buddy who played Trump.
Sure.
And won, and we will never let him, because he thought it was, like, the world's greatest achievement to beat Trump. I'm like, yeah, but Trump hasn't been really relevant outside of the streaming scene since, like, this first season, but we just like, oh man, did you beat Trump today?
My,
like, we'll play League, and like, if he starts to lose in his game, we'll be like, hey man, are you playing against Trump? Is he getting his revenge? He hates us. Like, he's like, I'm never talking to you guys again.
There's a guy on my Facebook feed who actively tries to play against Raynad on stream, and he's like, oh dude, I played Raynad today, almost won. Almost had him. I was like, okay, he's like an above average player when it like comes to like...
I used to do things like that with like League streams where like you just try and stream snipe and you'd play them and you'd beat them. And
And you're like, I'm accomplished. Yeah,
like,
I'm the master, brother.
Why are you like Macho Man Randy Savage and
I'm Macho
together?
Man Randy Hogan.
Okay.
Macho Mania, brother.
Okay, can I ask for a request?
Yeah.
The next time you shave, can you do the mutton chop?
Mutton chop.
And and then can you also get pictures of the Hulk Hogan? Can we get those? Can those be a thing?
Oh, you mean like the full like Civil War mutton chop that goes into
the
mustache?
Where you just get rid of the chin.
Yeah.
And you keep the rest.
Yeah, sure.
I want to see the evolution of...
I think I've done that. I think I think I got a picture of that somewhere, actually.
I think I need to see these. These need to be in my life.
Yeah. I've done the handlebars before for, like, a full couple days.
After...
it was very white trash.
After last year's No Shave November, my coworkers were like, you need to just get the porn stash for a day.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, can I not?
How's your stash? Is it good?
It was bad.
Bad like, in a good
first
way.
First of all, it's
is
a,
it
first
bushy?
Of all,
is it like Ned Flanders?
No.
Like, I wish I had a Ned Flanders stash.
Like,
I would rock it.
I gave myself an extra week and a half before No Shave November, and I still couldn't grow a damn beard.
Yeah,
like it was just it never formed. But when I shaved it and I just had the porn stash, it was like I felt like I wasn't allowed near schools. I looked like I was a pedophile, and it was not. I was not. I left work early that day to go home and shave. I was like, I've done my deed. We're dead. I'm leaving. And I went home and I shaved. And I'm like, never again. Never again.
That's a shame. I'm sorry for you.
I was sorry. I was sorry for everybody who had to look at that for the day.
Yeah, I think I'm growing this baby out for a while.
Do it up. Get the ZZ Top beard going.
I might. Emily hasn't said stop yet, so.
Well, as long as she's the one who determines how long it grows.
Honestly, yeah, she's. I don't have any problems with it yet, so.
You've got the Obi-Wan going right now. I love it.
Yeah, she was like, you know, whatever makes you happy, I don't care. I was like, well, all right, that's good to know for now. We'll see in another like 2 inches. It's like down here. It's like chest length. I could like mop my boobs with it or something. Do you want to talk any other video games?
I don't think I can follow that up with anything.
Fair enough. No one mops boobs like me. So, if people want to find you, they can go to Twitter.
Yeah, you go to Twitter. My handle is like right down here. It's
at
Enigma SSB. If you like Smash Brothers or want to talk about Smash, that's generally what the most of my Twitter is. Or if you ever want to play me, put the SSB in the front and just like add me on Nintendo Network. Be like, hey, let's play sometime. Just keep in mind that for the most part, I do like general competitive rule set. So no
what
items.
What is general competitive rule set? Is it five stock?
So, no, four. Two stock in oh. Smash 4.
Okay.
They're like
why?
As long
why
as
only two?
They're like for the most part, you can pretty much assume what the legal stages are. Anything without random hazards in it. But
can
if
I
you're
just
like,
say
hey,
something?
let's do like the old Melee days where it's like Fox only, Final Destination. Like, let's do it. I don't care. Feel free to hit me up on Twitter or Nintendo Network with that. I have a Twitch set up for the near future. In fact, right after we're done with this show, I'm heading out to see what kind of deal I can get on a PC. So within the next couple of weeks of the show, you'll be able to find me on that. I'll do all sorts of crazy fun stuff.
I hope so.
It'll be a lot of like The Witcher. Like when I get this PC set up, I'll play The Witcher. Like if that'll be the only game I play aside from Smash Sundays until I beat it.
I seem to remember you talking
Witcher
about The Witcher a lot, or Witcher.
It's a great series.
Yeah.
So I might if things work out that I could, I would stream it. And yeah, that'll be again that tag that's below.
Sure.
I don't know if or when that would happen. Twitter is probably the best place to follow me. Yeah, I basically show up whenever we do this show, generally half an hour after it's supposed to start. And
whoops.
Yeah, it is. It
next
is what
week
it
will
is.
Be better, I'm sure.
Only this much.
Oh well, we'll see. It might
and
be
this,
worse.
The reason we're going to be this much better is because there's this much more of a personality that's being added.
All right. So it, basically, if anyone wants to find you or figure out what you're doing, just follow him on Twitter. It's that at guy in that diagonal space that way. Whoop. Just
boom.
Yep. And
one thing I will apologize for is anybody who's watching this, whether it was live or the VOD, I do not control the autofocus on this stupid camera. I can't seem to fix it on Skype, but I can seem to fix it anywhere else. I'm probably just going to buy a new one.
I should just figure out how to hack your system and control your
control it's your a Skype
camera.
Problem. It's not the... Because like I've turned autofocus off and Skype just doesn't recognize it. So
yeah, my OBS
this
barely.
This webcam's like old. I've had this webcam since like people weren't using like Ace cards for Pokemon battles. That's how old this webcam is.
It's very old. It's very very old. Hey, can I say something really quick as a casual Smash fan?
Yeah. No, Little Mac doesn't bang.
No, yeah he does. But I'm very upset that. The classic Dreamland stage isn't in this game.
Okay, that has nothing to do with like casual fan or not. I think most people are sad that that's not a stage.
It's my favorite
given,
stage. It's my favorite
it's a great
music.
Stage. Especially given just like our tournament legal stage list is pretty crappy at the moment. Even like the 3DS version had Yoshi's Island. Yoshi's Island would have been sweet on the Wii U version. I want it. It's a beautiful stage. It's fair.
I'm sorry. Maybe it's future DLC. You'll have to pay for Kirby.
Well, the one cool thing about the recent update they did was the stage builder is now kind of... Like, you can now share your own built stages. So I'm actually curious to know if we ever get some that are really good, if they make it into the tournament scene, because they would be accessible to everyone.
Hey.
That would be pretty cool. Dope.
That's interesting. That's very interesting.
So we'll
see
how that plays out.
Yes. If you tuned in here, you are at my Twitch channel. You could go to my Twitter. It's the same as my Twitch channel. It is right here, down here. If you want to hit up YouTube, it's in the lower right hand corner.
It's below. It's like even further below me.
Yes. You can hit up my YouTube. And so this has been the first episode of Yo Gamecast. You like how I did that inflection?
Yo, Fizz.
Yes. Next week we will have a third member joining the team, and it should be great. I think you guys will enjoy it. I can't wait. I can't wait, honestly. I'm going to make him answer to his for his past sins of doubting me. It's going to be the first thing.
I know who it is, and I know what's going to happen.
Oh, we're talking about it. We're bringing it up.
But one question for these guys.
Yes.
Would be, do we have the set schedule in mind, or is that going to be something we'll have to address and then we can post on Twitter later? I don't know if our other member has confirmed the Monday at 1 p.m. Pacific time or not.
Yeah.
If he's fine with it, that's kind of when I think we've been planning on doing it. And
I mean, he hasn't said anything before. He just said something about this week. He was not available. We'll talk to him again and see what if that works out. If it doesn't, we'll see what happens.
Okay.
I mean, he was here. So, but, you know, whatever.
Oh, man, that's spoilers for anybody who's here watching.
It could have been anyone, though.
Oh, I think they know.
I think they do. And then I think maybe next week, if this starts getting enough headway, I can give you guys an email, and you guys could send in questions. If you don't want to wait, you can send them to my email, and...
Or you could just tweet them at us, let's be honest.
Yeah, you could. But if you really wanted to email me, it's yofizyotube@gmail.com. And I'll throw that up on the YouTube VOD so you can see it as a visual. What is wrong with you?
YoTube?
YoTube!
That's worse than your segues.
Get it on. Is it. That is all we have to talk about for this week. Next week, some new stuff. Maybe news will happen. If it doesn't, it'll be a very short show. We'll just abuse the third guy.
Hey, hey, Mike.
Yeah.
May the fourth be with you.
And may the fourth be with you and with all of you. Thanks for tuning in.